That man's name is Alan Turing, right? Alan Turing is a famous British pioneer in science, mathematics, and philosopher, a number of things. You probably don't know him because he was not alive in our times, but he was alive during the times of World War II. And so what happens is that when the British and the Allied forces were trying to figure out ways to defeat the Nazis and Hitler and whatnot, Alan Turing was part of the British School of Decoding, right? It is known as the Government Code of Cipher School that was over in England. And Alan Turing, fascinating person, unique in intelligence and knowledge, he built this machine. This machine is known as the Turing machine. And what this machine did is what it was able to decipher the codes that the Nazis were sending out, and it was giving them, by decoding the messages that were being sent among the Nazis, they were able to decipher, to find out exactly where were they located, where the enemy had their positions, their armies, their tanks, and where they were going to move in what way, in what position. And so obviously, it's like playing chess and already knowing what the other person is going to do, right? Or even checkers, if you prefer. And so this gave the Allied forces a great advantage because they already knew then, by that time, where exactly Hitler and his forces were going to move. And of course, by knowing that, guess what? That the historians say that this machine and this man, Alan Turing, with his invention, they shortened the World War II by 3 to 4 years. And millions of lives were saved because of the advantage that this machine had given the Allied forces. Now, why do I talk about this? It's because we are also in a spiritual warfare, and our enemy is on attack. We have an enemy that is trying to bring us down, that is trying to finish with us, and guess what? God has also given us a machine. God has also given us an instrument so that we can decode our enemy's moves. And in advance, what he's going to do, how he's going to carry out his deceptions in these times, right? And so when we look at the panorama of Revelation, when we look at the things that are happening in the world, we can understand and have confidence and say, you know what? The Bible said that this was going to happen. I knew this was coming along. Why? Because we have God's instrument to help us to decode the enemy's deceptions and the way the enemy is trying to trick every single human being on earth. And to that I say, amen. So, as we continue, my loved ones, when you look into prophecy, when you look at the Bible of Revelation, I'm sure many of you are afraid. I'm sure many people did not come tonight because when they saw Revelation, they're like, ooh, I'm not going to go there. That's scary, right? Ooh, I don't want to know about that. I don't want to be afraid. Why? Because when you look at Revelation, you have things like a lamb slayed with 7 horns, right? And 7 eyes. You look at, it talks about 7 trumpets that are going to be sounding upon the earth. Revelation talks about a woman standing on the moon and this dragon with 7 heads attacking her, right? Revelation talks about another woman sitting or standing on a beast with 7 heads. Revelation talks about this little horn power, this Antichrist power that is going to rise up on the earth. It talks about the beast, right? The beast of Revelation. Ooh, and people get all gooey about that. And they get all scared about these things. Revelation also talks about an image being lifted up. And when this image is lifted up, all shall worship. And then those that do not worship are going to receive a death sentence. Revelation talks about the mark of the beast, right? The famous 666, and how it's going to be sealed on the forehead. At the same time, it talks about what? God's people receiving what? Receiving a seal on their forehead also, right? Talks about the 7 plagues of Revelation, the plagues that are going to fall on the earth. And it talks about the lake of fire. Revelation says that the whole earth is going to be covered in fire in the same way it was covered with water during the times of Noah. And so when we look at this, I can understand why people would be afraid, right? Because you look at it and the panorama does not look very enticing, right? And so people usually, when they hear these types of things, they're afraid. They don't want to know. Now, all of these things are in Scripture for a reason. God has placed them there with a reason and for a purpose, and it's because He wants to prepare you and I. He wants us to be ready for the things that are about to come. Amen? And so we can be confident in knowing that God loves us so much that He wants us to be ready. And so the purpose of this seminar, my loved ones, is that you and I together, during this seminar, we are going to be decoding. We are going to be studying the book of Revelation in detail and, of course, the rest of the Bible so that we can understand what is God's message for us. What is he trying to tell us through the book of Revelation? Amen? And so, when I ask you, how many of you ever heard somebody tell you, oh, you can't understand the book of Revelation? Has anybody, raise your hand if somebody has told you that. Oh, you can't understand the book of Revelation, right? Or they're afraid of it, or they say you can't understand it. Oh, they'll tell you, oh, no. You need a PhD. Only the scholars, right? Only those that go and study theology. Those are the only people that can understand a book like the book of Revelation. And so even I've heard even people used to tell me, oh, no. God did not bring the book of Revelation for us to understand. It's not for us, right? I want to start to break with that paradigm. I want to break with this common concept that we cannot understand it, that we're not supposed to understand it, that it's not for us. So being that, let's go into the book of Revelation. Join me, please. If you have your Bible, if you did not bring a Bible tonight, I forgive you. That's okay. Don't worry about it. But this is going to be our textbook during our seminar, the Bible. So there are some Bibles in the pews, but if you need a Bible, you can raise your hand, and we also have Bibles if anybody needs a Bible. So if, let's say, for example, you did not bring your Bible and you would like to use a Bible, we have Bibles here. You could just raise your hand. Okay, we have a young woman over here in the front. Thank you very much. Or if you don't have a Bible, right? Let's say you don't have a Bible and you would like a Bible, raise your hand and we will gladly give you a Bible as a gift. There's another young lady right there. Very good. Thank you. There's another young lady over there with the hands. Just raise your hand. Don't be afraid, right? If you need a Bible, I have a gentleman over here in the front also. If it's Lent, if we're lending you the Bible because you have it and you just forgot it, when you go out at the end, just leave it on the table on your way out. If you don't have a Bible and you would like a Bible, we'll give you that Bible. Amen? That'll be a gift for you because we want you to have the Word of God in your hands. Who says amen to that? So I want to make sure that everybody in here has a Bible, right? And anybody else need a Bible tonight? Young man right there, he needs a Bible. One more Bible over here for the man in the third row with the blue shirt. Amen. Now, I want you to open your Bible. It's going to be real easy. Tonight we're going to go very simple. We're just going to go into one book. Guess what book that is? The book of Revelation. Go with me, please, to the last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is the last book in the Bible. Depending how much meat or your Bible has, you'll probably get there quickly. Or in my case, it takes me a while to get there. There we go. The book of Revelation, and we're going to go to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. We're going to start to unravel the mystery of Revelation. And we're going to start with this concept that we cannot understand Revelation. It's not for us to understand. It is not for us to be revealed. Let's see what the Bible says. Everybody there, raise your hand if you have it. Amen. Praise the Lord. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. What does it say? The what? Let's stop right there. The book starts with what phrase? The revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, what does the word revelation mean? Look at it right here, my loved ones. Here's the Greek word, right? The New Testament was written in ancient Greek. So the Greek word would be apocalypsis, right? In Spanish, that's why it's called apocalypsis. Or you hear about apocalyptical events, right? What does apocalypsis mean? It means a disclosure, a manifestation, a mystery to be revealed, an announcing of something that must be known to take what? To take the cover off. Notice, my loved ones, that the book of Revelation, the book that many people believe that you cannot understand, that you do not have the ability to understand, that is not revelation of God. The last book, Revelation starts with the phrase, the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so the word itself, the phrase itself, the title of the book is that what? It is that there is something that is a mystery. There is something that is uncovered. And what does God want to do? He wants to reveal it. Amen? Now, does he only want to reveal it to certain people? Does he only want to reveal it to a few privileged that maybe have that benefit or that privilege? Well, let's continue to read. Verse number 1. The revelation of who? Let's stop there again. The revelation of Jesus Christ. So, who is this revelation coming from? How many of you consider yourself a Christian? Raise your hand. Let me see. Right? I do too. So that means that if you consider yourself a Christian, this is a revelation of who? Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you one time I used to be a teacher in New York City, and I used to have Bible studies on lunch hours with some of my other guest teachers. And we would get together during these lunch hours, and we would start studying the Bibles and different places. Usually they like the teachers that work with me, they like to focus in on the Gospels. And I love the Gospels, right? But one day, you know, I wanted to spice things up a little bit. And I said, hey, ladies, have you girls ever read the book of Revelation? They're like, oh, no, Mr. Munoz. No, no, no. And they told me all the things that I've told you, right? Oh, that's not for us to know. We can't understand it. Oh, my pastor says no, and this and that. I'm like, okay, so I'm going to give you a homework. Next time when we get together, I want you girls to read Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, and come back and tell me what you think. Guess what? When we got back together on that Monday, they were all in the classroom waiting for me with their eyes open, popped out like fish in a fridge, right, in a freezer. Like, whoa. And I said, so how did it go, ladies? And they said, Mr. Munoz, Revelation is a message from Jesus Christ. I'm like, yes. And I told them, do you love Jesus? We love Jesus. And I said, then Revelation is for you and for me. Amen? They're like, we didn't know that. And so in the same way that I started to study the book of Revelation and show them something that they were not aware of, that's what we're doing here during this seminar. Amen? We're coming together. We want to know and we want to see what is the message that Christ is trying to reveal, that Christ is trying to give to his people, to his church. Who says amen for that? Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's continue to read. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants. Things which must what? Which must take place shortly. So that means that something is going to happen, and that is the purpose of Revelation, is to what? Is to announce these things. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ and to all the things that he saw. Now watch this, verse 3. Blessed is he or she who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is. Notice, my loved ones, that there is a blessing. How many of you like to receive blessings from God? Raise your hand. So it says in the same book that a lot of people say, you can't understand it, you're not going to get it, you need to go to school, you need to do this. In the same book it says that it is a revelation from Jesus Christ to what? In regards to prophecy, things that are going to happen. And there is a blessing to those that do what? Read it, like we've just been reading. So we're already receiving a blessing, amen? To those that hear it, maybe you're not reading it, but you're listening to it. And to those that what? It said, and to those that keep. You know what that phrase, that word means, keep? It means that cherish, that follow and obey what it says, amen? Why? Because it says that there's a prophecy. Now that word prophecy, some people get a little scared with it also. What does the word prophecy mean? Well, here it is. In Greek, it's the word prophetikos, right? During this seminar, we're going to go talk a little bit about the Hebrew and the Greek in scriptures. You're also going to learn a little bit of Spanish with me. And so, what does prophecy mean? It's a prediction. A what? A forecast. It's an announcing of future events. It's a vision into what? It's a vision into the future. So if we put this together, in other words, the book of Revelation is a revelation. It's an uncovering. It's a message from God through his son Jesus Christ about specific events that are going to happen in the future that God wants us to know about so that we're what? So that we're ready when all of these things happen. Who says amen to that? So if, we're pretty packed tonight, but I'm sure if we were to put out there on the street, your future is going to be revealed here tonight, we probably wouldn't have to get a bigger building, right? But that's exactly what Revelation is. That's what it's saying. He says, I'm going to let you know and I'm going to bless you because I want you, Jesus says, I want you to know these things. I want you to be prepared. Who says amen for that? Woo! So if you say amen, amen, just means, you know what, I agree with what you're saying, brother. And so you can just say amen if you feel like it. I'm from Hispanic churches. They get a little fired up, all right? But I like the fact that you're animated too, right? You're in there. So don't be afraid to say amen if I say something that really shakes you or you're like, yeah, I agree with that. Who says amen? Now, a lot of people think it's not important to study prophecy. Some people say, I've come across people of all walks, and they say, oh, no, prophecy is not important. It's not important. The only thing that's important is Jesus. right? And so again, I go, well, if you look at the book of Revelation, he's himself is sending the message saying, I'm giving you this prophecy of revelation, so it is a blessing for your life, amen? Now, is prophecy important? Look at what it says in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18. Without prophecy, God's people would what? Would perish. So prophecy is the guide. It's a light that God sends to his people so that they know where they're walking, so that they know exactly what is coming along. Now, a lot of people say, okay, Carlos, you got me. I understand now that I can get it. But why is it so difficult to understand prophecy? Why is it that it's so hard? I mean, I've read through the book of Revelation, and all I get is a headache, right? My hair pops out, and the beast and dragon and all of this. What? Why is it so difficult to understand? The Bible talks about this also in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Peter says, as also in all his epistles, he's talking about the writings of Paul, where there are some things in them that are what? Hard to understand, right? There are some things that you need to put a little bit more effort, which the ignorant and unstable, what do? They twist to their own destructions, as they do also with what? With the rest of Scripture. So Peter was already warning that as it was happening with the writings of Paul and with the rest of Scripture, what happens is that there's so much confusion. Why? Because what do people do? What do ignorant and unstable people do with it? They twist it. They turn it. In other words, they try to interpret things on their own way, on their own knowing, right? Oh, this is what I think Revelation says. This person told me what this says. This other person believes this, and this is what I do. And you know what? Sadly, most of the information that we have sometimes is because we've just heard somebody else say it, right? But we've never really discovered or studied it for ourselves. And this is what Paul is saying, and he continues to say, you therefore, he's talking to you, beloved, knowing this beforehand, knowing that there are people that are going to twist the scriptures, beware that you are not being led away by the errors of lawless people. So Paul is warning us, and Peter, listen, be careful with people that try to twist, that try to turn scripture to their own way. And so, I'm going to give you a promise during this seminar. It does not matter what I think. It does not matter what I believe. It does not matter what I was taught. It does not matter what I heard from anybody else. The only thing that matters during this prophecy seminar is what does God say in his word. Amen? God is his own interpreter of his own word. He is the one that gave this to us through the Holy Spirit and the prophets. And so actually my job is pretty easy. All I have to do is come here and let the Bible speak for itself. Amen? And so during this seminar, if in any moment I say anything and I do not have biblical support for what I am presenting or a point that I am making, you are more than welcome to call me out on it. All right? Because everything that I present, it doesn't matter what I say or what I believe. What matters is what does God say in his word. Who says amen? And that's a promise for that. And I'll go up again to Peter because he says in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 20, knowing this first that what? Some prophecy of Scripture is of private interpretation. How many prophecy of Scripture is of private interpretation? None. It doesn't matter what any of us believe. It doesn't matter what the pastor says. It doesn't. What matters is if what the person is saying is founded on the Word of God. Amen? That's what matters, my loved ones. And so you come across, my loved ones, there are not, they interpret Scripture this way, and this person interprets prophecy this way. No, there are not two ways of interpreting. There's only one way. It's the correct way, amen, or the wrong way. There are not multiple interpretations to the things that we are going to be learning. God has a message. He is being very clear, and he wants us to prepare, amen. The Bible says that God is not a God of confusion. God is not going to say, watch out for the mark of the beast, watch out for the beast, and then have us running around like chickens without heads, trying to figure out what is the beast and what is the mark. If God is warning us about these things, in his word, he is going to clearly explain them to us. Amen? And he is going to have one interpretation because he's not going to want everybody, some people understanding it this way, some people are interpreting it this way. God is very clear in his word, and we're going to see tonight that he's also quite repetitive with these things. Who says amen? Now, can we understand? How can we understand these things? This is a question that is made in the Bible also. And look at what it says in Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. God says, call to me, and I will respond, and I will show you great and hidden things that you did not what? That you did not know. So what do we need to do? Ask, right? What does Jesus say in Matthew chapter 7? Ask and you shall. Seek and knock and you. That's why you're here. That's why a lot of you came here, because you received the handbill. Somebody invited you and you said, you know what? I want to know more. God, maybe it's happened even before you came. You were already thinking, Lord, I want to understand better prophecy. I want to study the book of Revelation, but I don't know how to. And guess what happened? You received your handbill. Amen? You received an invitation. This is not coincidence. I have people that come and say, I've been praying for months to want to understand the book of Revelation because they don't. Nobody can explain it. And I said, this is what it is. God has answered your prayers so that you can come here. Who says amen? Now, what are we going to do? We're going to ask, we're going to seek, and we are going to knock. For what? For knowledge and understanding of the Word of God. Who says amen for that? Now, tonight we're going to start with, how can I understand the Bible? Tonight I'm going to teach you four principles. Four principles that we are going to be using during the whole prophecy seminar. Principles that are going to help us to understand Scripture. These are four principles of interpretation to understand Revelation, or four principles to interpret or understand apocalyptical literature. Now, what do I mean by apocalyptical literature or apocalyptical prophecy? There are different types of prophecy in the Bible, right? You have normally the classic prophecy that you probably find in every book in the Bible that you do find. For example, prophecies in regards to the Messiah, right? There's a lot of prophecies. But when we talk about apocalyptical prophecies, those types of prophecies are specifically focused on the end times, on the end of this earth. And so while there are two books in the Bible that focus in on end time prophecy or apocalyptical prophecy, who can guess which two books are those? Daniel and Revelation. So when I'm talking about Revelation, we're going to see that Revelation is just a continuation of the book of Daniel. They're like peanut butter and jelly, right? They're like Batman and Robin. They go hand in hand. And so we're going to see that they come together. So what we're going to do tonight as we open is an introduction, because what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to lay the foundation for you and how we are going to study the book of Revelation and the Bible for the rest of this seminar. So four basic principles of interpretation. Now, these are not the only ones. These are just the four that I believe are most relevant for us, especially as we're starting to study the Bible, so we can get a good grasp of it. Then later on, we can talk about some of the other principles. Who says amen for that? Amen. So let's start with the first of this, of these principles of interpretation, and it would be what? The chronology in the chapters. What do I mean by that? I come across people that, when I was starting to study the book of Revelation, I came across people that would read Revelation in chronological order, right? They would read chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way to 22, and they would read it as if it was one linear movement, right? It was going in the same way, and what happens is that causes a lot of confusion. Notice that Revelation has a very interesting way of presenting things, and it's not always in chronological order. Well, so what do I mean by that? If I were to ask anybody, what do you think would be the first chapter in Revelation if you were following chronological order, what would everybody usually say? Revelation chapter 1, right? But you're wrong. If you were to follow the book of Revelation in chronological order, you know which would be the first chapter in chronological order? Revelation chapter 12. What? That's in the middle. Why? Watch. Go with me, please, to Revelation chapter 12. I'm going to show you this principle. Revelation chapter 12. We're going to go to Revelation chapter 12, and we're going to study Revelation chapter 12 in great detail in the future. It's actually, if you ask me, Carlos, what is your favorite chapter in the book of Revelation? It's Revelation chapter 12, and you'll see why, because it's just, whew. I mean, Revelation is almost, you can consider it, a summary of the Bible, and chapter 12 of Revelation is a summary of the whole Bible in Revelation. That's how fascinating this chapter is. So go with me to Revelation chapter 12. Who's there? Amen. Look at what it says here. It says, now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with what? With the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Now, have you ever looked out to the sky and seen a woman standing on the moon? Be like, oh, look at that woman over there. She's standing on the moon. No. So immediately you know that something is off, right? Let's continue to read. It says, then being with what? With child. So being with child means that she's what? She's pregnant. It says, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. So this woman standing on the moon is about to give birth. Now, if you just come up to the first time in Book of Revelation and you read, you're just like, this doesn't sound right. Is this giant human woman is standing upon the moon? But if you studied Revelation, for example, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15 and 16, there's a prophecy there. The first prophecy in the Bible where God told the devil, he says what? Out of the woman is going to come a seed. And that seed that is going to come out of the woman, you are going to give him a mortal wound. But guess what? He is going to destroy you. I call that the mother of all prophecies. The mother of all prophecies is Genesis chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. We're not going to study it tonight, but we're going to study it on next Thursday night. We're going to focus in on that verse because it's a fascinating verse. And so here what we're seeing is that prophecy is being fulfilled because the woman is about to what? Is about to give birth. Who do you think is about to be born, my loved ones? The seed, the Messiah, Christ. Amen? So notice that in Revelation chapter 12, Christ has not been born yet. In the first verses. And then when you go to verse number 4, in verse number 5, it says, she bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and his throne. So notice that Jesus is technically not born until verse number 5, right? And so what is it saying? It's because if you try to study the book of Revelation in chronological order, you're going to get confused. What God does in Revelation and in Daniel, in the apocalyptical literature, he does something fascinating. And it's called repeat and enlarge. What is it called? Or repeat and amplify. It's also known as a recapitulation. I don't know if I said it correctly in English. In Spanish, it's recapitulación, right? But you know, I know you don't have tongues yet. So recapitulation, right? And so what it's saying is it's a repeat and enlarge, a repeat and enlarge. Is anybody here a teacher? Anybody here a teacher by profession? Okay, we have some teachers there. In teaching or in education, there is something known as the zone of proximal development. And what does that mean? That means is that when a child, for example, goes, let's say a child goes into kindergarten for the first time. When a child walks into kindergarten, do they start teaching them algebra and geometry? No, why not? It's way above their head, right? So what does a zone of proximal development mean? It means that you start where the child is and you what? You build on that, right? And so what you do through school really is a repeat and enlarge. Repeat and enlarge. Math, adding, subtracting, multiplying, division, and then you start adding and adding. Everybody with me? God does the same thing in prophecy. He starts with something very basic, very elementary that we can easily understand, and then he builds on it. He builds on it. He builds on it. So, for example, when we start studying specifically about the beast and the Antichrist, we're going to start in Daniel. And we're going to see that Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8, Daniel chapter 9. We're going to continue to build as it goes and it builds and more and more and more. You know what that does? It helps us to understand that I am not interpreting Scripture, but God is. Because it's so repetitive, what happens is that we say, oh, I saw that already. And God says, you remember that? Now I'm going to give you a little bit more information. And he continues to bring us along. That helps us to understand that we're understanding and interpreting the prophecy correctly. Who says amen for that? And so we're going to see, for example, first it starts with a woman. Then it says that there's a dragon, right, that attacks the woman, a dragon that brings in the woman. So I'll give you another example. For example, in Daniel chapter 7, it talks about four beasts. How many beasts? Four beasts. But then when you go to Revelation chapter 13, it talks about one beast. And then when you go to Revelation chapter 17, it talks about a woman, what? Sitting on the beast. And so what is God doing? He's starting with something very basic understanding, and then he's building, he's building, he's building, so that when we get to Revelation 17, which we will study in great detail, we know, I already know the previous clues, I already know the other foundation, so it's going to come to life and it's going to come easily as we follow the pattern that God has given us. Who says amen for that? So God has these patterns that he follows. God is a mathematician, amen? God is a scientist. God uses all, he's a poet, and he uses all of this to draw our attention, to draw us into Scripture so that we can understand God, so that we can be in awe and marveled in who God is, amen? Number two, not only the chronology in chapters, but also what? The symbolic language, right? We talked about these things already. We talked about beast, and we talked about all of these aspects that appear. So, for example, let's talk about the dragon. Let's put this this principle of interpretation to the test. The Bible talks about this beast that is rising up. Go with me to Revelation chapter 13. I want you to read it with me, please. Revelation chapter 13. Watch this with me. We're not only learning these principles, I want to apply them. And what we're going to do is when we finish, we're going to read a chapter in Revelation that is going to summarize these 4 points and bring it all home. So watch this. Revelation chapter 13. When you're there, say amen. It says, then I stood on the sand of the what? Of the sea. And I saw a what? A beast rising up out of the sea, having what? 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now you read that immediately, like, ooh, I don't want to read that, right? That looks like something from some movie in Hollywood, like Lord of the Rings, some beast coming out and some Godzilla going to eat it. Well, let's continue to read. Verse 2. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. Now you're probably reading this, you're like, what is going on here, right? I have no clue what God is trying to tell me with this. What is going on? Don't worry about it. Watch how the Bible is going to explain these two verses in a very basic and simple way that anybody could understand. So let's start with the beast. What does a beast represent? Is this some mean Godzilla coming out of the water? The fourth beast shall be a what? A fourth kingdom on the earth. Now, did your ear fall off because of that? You still have your teeth? Very simple. What does a beast represent in prophecy? A kingdom, a nation, that's it. So it's saying that a beast is going to come up from among the sea, right? So what does the sea mean? Is it going to come out of the Pacific Ocean, right? No. Watch what the sea or waters represent. Revelation 17, 15. The waters which you saw are what? People, multitudes, nations, and tongues. So that means that the seas in Scripture represent where there are lots of people, right? A conglomerate of people from different nations, multitudes, different languages. So I have a question. Would this kingdom be able to rise up out of Antarctica? No, why not? Because you have maybe some scientists in Antarctica, but really don't. Would this beast be able to rise up, this kingdom, out of the Sahara Desert? No, because there has to be lots of nations, notions. I said it in Spanish and English. I said Spanglish. Nations and tongues where there's lots of people. Would this beast be able to rise up, let's say, for example, in New York City? Yes, right? Because there's lots of people. Now, of course, we know a kingdom is not going to rise up out of a city, but you get the point, what I'm trying to say. Amen? So that's what waters or sea represent. It's this kingdom that is going to rise up where there are lots of nations, where there are already a lot of people. Now, let's get a little bit deeper. What are the heads? It said 7 heads. The 7 heads are what? 7 mountains on which the woman sits. So mountains, now it's talking geography. Amen? Anybody here like geography? The Bible has it all. I mean, it doesn't matter whether you like zoology, whether you like geography, meteorology, numbers, everything is in Scripture. Here it says that those 7 heads are 7 mountains where this woman, where this beast is coming up from. Now, what about the dragon? If you ask somebody, what does the dragon represent? They'll say, China. That's what they all say. So they say, oh, that means China is going to give this kingdom power. Remember, we don't interpret prophecy or the Bible based on what we know, our contemporary information. We let Scripture interpret itself. Amen? What does the dragon represent? Revelation 12, 9. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called who? The devil and Satan, which deceives those in Africa. Sorry, I'm getting old. He deceives those in South America. Pay attention. The dragon, it says, is the devil. And how many people does he have deceived? What does that imply? If you're sitting here today and you're saying, "Woo! I am not deceived." That's exactly where the devil wants you. Because if you're not aware of the deception, then it's a deception. If you know it's a deception, then you can't be deceived. So implying or thinking, oh, I'm fine, I got it great, I'm good to go, watch out. Because that's where the devil wants us, thinking that we're perfectly fine, and yet it says, not some of the world, not the Western Hemisphere, not South America, not Europe, the whole world is deceived, my loved ones. And that's why when we study Revelation chapter 17, it says that the whole world is drinking of the wine of Babylon. Ooh. We're going to break all of that down, so don't get afraid, amen? Remember, this is information that God wants us to have. Why? So that we are not deceived in the end times. And falling into deception, my loved ones, I'll be very straight with you, falling into the devil's deceptions means losing salvation. Because we have to not come out of the darkness, come out of deception, and follow the glorious light of Jesus Christ. And that light includes the book of Revelation. It's the one book that nobody wants to study. It's the one book that people don't focus on. It's the one book that I've had people say, I've never heard anybody speak about Revelation. And you wonder why. Why? Because the devil doesn't want us to study the book of Revelation. So you are exactly where God wants you. Amen? God wants you here because he wants to reveal these things to us, my loved ones, because this is not a regional deception. This is not just a, this is a worldwide issue. And all of this, my loved ones, we're going to see how it breaks down in such clarity that it is amazing. The detail that God gives us, dates, people, places, historic events, contemporary events that are happening right now are all in the book of Revelation, and I'm going to show it to you during this seminar. Who says amen? I'm starting to warm up. Woo, this is exciting. This is fun. Amen? And so now let's go back. Let's go back to that verse in Revelation chapter 13, verse 1 and 2. And I saw a beast. You tell me, what does a beast represent? So John sees a nation rise up out of the sea, which is what? Where there are people, multitudes, tribes, tongue, people. And that beast or that kingdom had what? Seven heads, which is what? Seven mountains, and the dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. There's China again. Not China? Who's the dragon? The devil. What is it telling us? That the devil is going to rise up a nation on this earth, and through this nation, he is going to deceive the whole world. Ooh. Do you think God is going to warn us about this beast and then be like, you know what? Now that you know, now go running out and go find out what that beast is. No, my loved ones, we need to study. Amen? These are some basic elements of prophecy study. We're going to go deeper because, you know, as you go deeper in, you got to put a little bit more effort. We're going to go deep into these prophecies. We're going to break all of this down, Revelation chapter 13, in detail because God is warning us about the things that are coming. Who says amen to that? Praise the Lord. Now, principle of interpretation number three. First one is, who can repeat it? Let's see. Number one? Chronology. Remember, it's not a chronological. There's a chronological foundation to the book of Revelation, but it's cyclical, right? It's repetitive. That's why you have seven churches. You have seven seals. You have seven trumpets. It's the same information presented from different angles or different perspectives. Who says amen? What's number two? Let's see if you remember. The symbolism, right? It's full of symbolism. Apocalyptic literature has lots of symbols. And so we need, where do we find the key to unlock those symbols or decode them? In the Bible itself, amen? Number three, my loved ones, the book of Revelation is located where? In the sanctuary. Now, you're probably here saying, in the what? In the sanctuary. And you're like, oh, I heard about the sanctuary. Yeah, they told me that Moses built a sanctuary in the desert. And they told me that then Solomon, King David, Abraham, and then it was destroyed. And then and I think now everybody's waiting because now the Muslims are there and everybody's paying attention to the sanctuary. I'm going to tell you something. The sanctuary is just more than a building or a place. The sanctuary, my loved ones, is the foundation of the plan of salvation for each and every one of us. What? Yes. The sanctuary is a fascinating, amazing instrument that God gave us to teach us how he is going to cleanse us from sin. Praise the Lord. Why? Because, my loved ones, to be able to dwell in the presence of God, we cannot have the stain of sin. We need to be pure and holy because God is pure and holy. The sanctuary breaks this down, and I'm going to show you now that the book of Revelation is actually located in the sanctuary, but not on the earthly sanctuary, because technically there's no sanctuary over there right now in Jerusalem. It's talking about a greater teaching is the sanctuary in heaven. And you're like, what? There's a sanctuary? There's a temple in heaven? Yes. Watch this. Inside of the sanctuary, this is a place called the holy place, and there are three pieces of furniture. You have the showbread, the altar of incense, and the candlestick. Go with me to Revelation chapter 8. I want to show you this. Revelation chapter 8. If you notice, we're just picking and dabbing. I'm just trying to establish some foundations so that we can get a little bit of grasp. I hope enough to tickle you to return tomorrow. Amen? Because this is just a warm-up, my lovers. This is like when you go to Costco and you know they have the food there and you come out and you pick it. And then you go around and you come out and pick it again, right? This is what we're talking about. So we're picking a number of times. I know you do it because I do it too. Amen? When nobody's looking, I'll grab like five. My wife's like, stop taking so much. And then when I turn around, she grabs them. I'm like, come on, right? Revelation chapter 8. Revelation chapter 8. Everybody there? Look at what it says in verse number 3. Revelation chapter 8, verse 3. It says, then another angel, having a golden what? A golden censer, came and stood at the altar. Okay, there's an altar. He was given much what? Incense. So if there's incense, then that means it must be what? An altar of incense. Now watch this. That he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. We're going to see that the Ark of the Covenant represents the throne of God. So technically, right here, when you cross over the altar of incense, there's the Ark of the Covenant, and that's what it's mean when it says it's standing and spending in front of the throne of God. Oops, I'm sorry. Here we go. Let's continue to read. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hands. Now watch this in Revelation in verse 5. Then the angel took the censer, he filled it with fire from the, and he threw it into heaven. Where did he throw it? If he threw it to earth, that means that that altar of incense cannot be on earth. It has to be where? In heaven. Ooh, I know I just blew your mind away. That's okay. That's just a tickle. That's just a little taste at Costco, remember? A little tickle. It says, and he threw and the fire, and there was noise, thunders, lightnings, and earthquake. I just showed you that when we're talking about a sanctuary, the sanctuary that was on earth was just a model, a miniature, a representation of the true sanctuary in heaven. Who says amen? You want to see another one? Let's do another one. Let's go into the most holy place of the sanctuary. Don't worry. On Sunday night, I'm going to give you a walk through the sanctuary with the services. I'm going to break it down so you understand the wonderful, marvelous truths of the plan of salvation. But when we go into the most holy place, there's the Ark of the Covenant. Remember the one that Indiana Jones is still looking for? Right? That's the one. Now, he's looking for it, but I found it in Revelation. Go with me to Revelation chapter 11. Go with me to Revelation chapter 11. Watch this. Don't you just love when we're moving from one book to the other? Right? We're just starting out in Revelation because it's our first night. Then we're going to start going into many other books to study, because you cannot study Revelation without the rest of the Bible. Revelation chapter 11, verse 19, who's there? Amen? It says, then the temple of God was opened on earth. In heaven. And what did John see? And the Ark of the Covenant was seen in his temple, and guess what happened again? And there were lightnings, noisings, thunderings, earthquake, and great hail. Woo! So now we see the Ark of the Covenant where? Again, in heaven. Can I hear an amen? So when we look at the sanctuary, my loved ones, God is trying to give us a representation, a model, a blueprint of not a sanctuary here on earth. That's just something that is trying to point us where? Into heaven. And guess what? In heaven, as in the earthly sanctuary, there were priests that ministered in that sanctuary. So that should indicate to us that if there were priests ministering in the earthly sanctuary, then there should be priests ministering where? In the heavenly sanctuary. Look at what it says in Hebrews 9:24. For Christ has not entered into the sanctuary made with hands. That's the earthly one that was here. But where has he entered into? Which is a figure a representation, a shadow of the true sanctuary. But he went into heaven itself now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Now, who is the one that would enter into the sanctuary on behalf of God's people? It was the high priest. He was the only one that would be able to go into the sanctuary in representation of the nation. Now I have a question. Do we have an earthly high priest representing us? Who is our high priest representing us in the sanctuary above in heaven? It says Hebrews 8:1-2, we have such a high priest who is sat on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens and minister of the sanctuary and of the true sanctuary, the real tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. Amen? So Jesus Christ in Revelation, my loved ones, is represented as walking through the heavenly sanctuary. He is up there. He is on the right hand of the Father, and we're going to talk about all that later on in the seminar as we go deeper and deeper. Remember, I'm just laying the foundation. I'm just throwing some cement so that we can get tickled with everything that's here. Who says amen? Because we're going to see how wonderful. And tonight, I'm going to give you a little taste of exactly what this is. Now, our fourth and last principle, let's review. What's the first principle of interpretation? Chronology. Number two, symbolism. Number three, sanctuary. Amen? To be able to understand the book of Revelation, we have better, to get a greater knowledge, we need to study the sanctuary. Amen? And the sanctuary is where Revelation is taking place, the services and those things. So that's what we're going to be doing as the night follows. Number four, Christ is the center. Amen? Christ is the main and principal player in Revelation. He is the hero. He is the main character. He is the focus of Revelation. Lucas 24:27. Oh, I tell so you know how to say Luke in Spanish, right? I told you you're going to be learning Hebrew, some Greek, and some Spanish as well. Amen? So Lucas, what did he say in chapter 24? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them in all the scriptures the things concerning. All things must be fulfilled, said Jesus, which were written in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms concerning. My loved ones, this book that we have in our hands is the revelation of Jesus Christ from Genesis chapter 1 until Revelation chapter 22. It all points, it all focuses, it all zones in on Jesus Christ. Amen? And so what I'm saying is that if that applies to all the Bible, do you think it doesn't apply to Revelation? I already showed you it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so everything is about Christ. He is the center. He is the focus. Everything should point us to Jesus from the beginning to the end, in the middle, and everywhere around it. And we're going to see that during this seminar. I promise you that I'm going to show you Jesus Christ during this seminar as you've never seen him before. Never, I promise you. You're going to see Jesus Christ in a totally new light, in a totally amazing way. And I'm just sharing with you the things that I have been learning. Look at what Jesus says in John 5:39. You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. But these are they that testify of. In other words, he's saying, you think that because you study the scripture, because you study the word, you think that you're going to live, you have eternal life. You're wrong. The Bible does not save anyone. The Bible points us to Christ, and Christ is salvation. He is the one who saves, amen? And it's interesting to notice, when Luke writes and when Jesus writes, the New Testament was not written yet. So when he's talking about Moses, the prophets, the Psalms, everything points to him. He's not even making reference to the New Testament. And I say this because I come across people that say, oh, don't worry about the Old Testament, that's old, put it away with, watch out. Because you're putting Jesus to the side too, because Jesus is in the Old Testament. He is hidden under all the symbolisms, under all that, and he is revealed in the New Testament in a powerful, powerful way, pointing to all of the things that were already written. Who says amen? Now, I say this why? Because I've come across prophecy teachers or prophecy seminars, and they focus on the beast, on the Antichrist. They focus on all these other things, and they forget about who? They forget about Jesus. Right? And so what it is, if you come to a prophecy seminar like that, you're just going to listen to information, history, events. It's going to be good information. It might even entertain you for a little bit. But at the end, you're going to walk out just the same way you are. Why? Because without Jesus, this is worth nothing. Listen to me, my loved ones. Prophecy does not save. Jesus is the one that saved. Amen? Amen. But Jesus gives us prophecy so that we can follow that path of salvation and steer and stay on that right track. Amen? So Jesus is the foundation, and prophecy is one of the tools that he uses to guide us and direct us in the direct light. Who says amen for that? Amen? And so when we're going to study about this, we're going to see that Revelation presents Christ as the Lamb. But not just as the Lamb. As I just told you, he's represented as the priest as well. And he's also represented as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen? All of these different aspects of the ministry of salvation of Jesus Christ are presented in the book of Revelation, and we're going to study them. Who says amen for that? About that? Now, here's the review. Four principles of interpretation to understand Revelation. Number one, the chronology and chapters. Number two, the symbolic language. Number three, located in the sanctuary. And number four, Christ is the? We're going to apply these four principles throughout this seminar, and we're going to learn some more. But now I want to do a summary reading with you. Go with me to Revelation chapter 1. Watch this. Revelation chapter 1. Now we're going to look at all of these four principles applied in some way, shape, or form. Watch how all of these four principles come to life. Revelation chapter 1. So here's the first vision that John receives on the book of Revelation. Amen? Everybody there? Say amen. 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 Revelation chapter 1. Are you ready? We're going to start on verse number 10. This is the first vision. It says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. Let's jump to verse 12. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me, and having turned, I saw what? Seven golden what? Seven golden lampstands. You already that are here already know. Where do we find seven golden lampstands? In the sanctuary. Amen? And specifically in what place? In the holy place. Now watch this. Verse number 13. And in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girded about the chest with a golden band. Now, who in the Bible is made reference to as the Son of Man? Jesus Christ. And notice the cloth that he has on. That's the cloth of a priest. And it says also, let's continue to read. In verse number 14, his head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in the furnace, and his voice as the sounds of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. You're already like, what is going on? But remember, this is what? This has a lot of symbols. Very good. Watch how it's going to interpret the symbols itself. Verse 17. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. I am the what? The first and the last. Now pay attention to verse 18. I am he who lives and was dead. Let's stop there. I am he who lives and I was dead. I have a question. Is this giving us a time frame for Revelation chapter 1? Yes. Jesus was dead, and now he is alive. He's not in an earthly sanctuary. He's in the heavenly sanctuary, because John wrote Revelation in the year 90. The earthly sanctuary was destroyed by the Romans in the year 70. So the sanctuary was not standing at this moment. It was destroyed. Jesus is standing in the lampstand, and John sees him, and Jesus says, I was dead, and now I am alive. Amen? So that means that this has to happen when? After the resurrection of Jesus Christ in the first century. Everybody with me? Time, location, everything is explained. Now let's continue to read to finish. He says, I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. Praise the Lord for that. Amen. That means that those that are with Christ, he has the power to free us from death and from Hades. Who says amen to that? Verse 19. Write the things which you have seen and the things which are and the things which will take place after this. Now watch how Jesus interprets the vision. The mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven. Now, seven numbers are also symbolic. Who can tell me what the seven represent? Seven is a number that represents what? Completion, totality, perfection. What is going on? When I read chapter 1, I said, what is happening here? Jesus Christ is standing among the lampstands, so that means he's in the holy place, not in an earthly sanctuary, in the heavenly sanctuary. And the first vision of Revelation has Jesus standing there. And my question was, why? Why does not have Jesus on the cross? Why doesn't have Jesus in the most holy place? Why does it have Jesus and the lampstands in the most holy place? And that's when it hit me. Seven churches representing what? The totality of God's church, of God's people. Why? This is the reason. Jesus knew, and a lot of people, when they jump to Revelation, they jump chapter 1, and that's why sometimes we lose the essence of it. Revelation chapter 1, what Jesus is saying is, listen, my loved ones, my children, my church, what is going to happen from this moment forth, now that I have been resurrected, and now that the Holy Spirit has descended on Pentecost, and now that my church is going to go out and preach the word, this is what's going to happen to you, my loved ones. There's going to be persecution. There's going to be rebellion. There's going to be apostasy. There's going to be tribulation in the church. The church is going to go through some really, really hard times, horrific times. And that's why when you read the book of Revelation, you see plagues, you see beasts, you see all of these things, you see catastrophe, you're scared. But what Jesus is telling his church in the first chapter, he's saying, despite all of these things that are going to happen, despite the down things that are going to, despite this looking like it's not going to be successful, listen to me, my church and my loved ones. I want you to know that I am among you. I am with you until the end. I will walk you through these trials and tribulations. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will encourage you. I will fortify you. I will be with you always. Amen. And so the first chapter in Revelation is a message of encouragement to us that sometimes we go through hard times. Sometimes we feel like we're beaten. Sometimes we feel like we can't do it anymore. Sometimes we feel like the enemy has overcome us and we have no hope. And Jesus is telling us from the very beginning, do not worry, my children. I am among you. I am with you. I am the captain of this ship. Stay on the ship because this ship is going to heaven. Amen. That's the message of Revelation, my loved ones, chapter 1, as Jesus. So when God gives us prophecy, my loved ones, he's giving us so that we can have faith and trust in his word. He's giving us so that we understand that God is in control, amen? He knows what's going to happen already. And so he's given all of this information so that we can be prepared, so that we can have faith and know, I knew this was going to happen, and now I know that the time is short for Christ to return, amen? Because he wants his people to be prepared, my loved ones. So what is the central theme of the Bible? What is the central theme of the book of Revelation? It is the love of Jesus Christ for each and every one of us, my loved ones. That's what the purpose is. It's he's giving us this message because he wants us to be prepared. He wants us to stay firm. He wants to use us as his instruments to reach out to other people. He wants to bless you. He wants to guide you. He wants you to be in heaven with him, my loved ones. He wants us, and so that's why he's warning us through the wonderful book of Revelation. Who says amen for that? Amen. Are you excited to study the book of Revelation, my loved ones? I've just tiptoed and dabbled around it, my loved ones, a little bit, just trying to encourage you, my loved ones, that this is just opening night, amen? We're just getting warmed up as we begin our fascinating study in the book of Revelation. So I conclude with the purpose of this seminar. Number one, what is the purpose? That you learn to study and understand the Bible and its end time prophecies. Amen? Number two, that you go and teach others what you are learning. Amen, right? When you find a treasure, if you are a loving person and you have other loved ones, you want to share this treasure with others. Amen? I want to share with you so you can share with others. Number three, to teach you how to live a faithful life in the present and prepare for the for the coming future, my loved ones. And number four, which is the most important purpose of this seminar, is that I want you to fall in love with his word. I want you to fall in love with Jesus Christ. Amen? That is salvation. Only those that love Christ, only those that fall in love with him, are those that are going to persevere and withstand anything that comes, saying, I know my Jesus, he's with me, and he is going to walk me through these things. Amen? And so as we finish, my loved ones, and we look at Jesus Christ among us, and we see the things that are happening in the world, my loved ones, I don't know about you, but volcanoes erupting, earthquakes all over the place, right? You have wars and rumors of wars. You have all of these things. This first month of 2020 of this decade has been very prophetic. I don't know about you, but I'm like, woo. I mean, I'm going to show you that that's nothing to what Revelation has. And why? Because God wants us to prepare. And so I'll use a story. Right now I'm from Puerto Rico, and there were a lot of earthquakes recently, and there were some tsunami warnings. And so this reminded me of the tsunami, if you remember, a tsunami that hit in the year 2004. Who remembers that tsunami? Right? Major tsunami that hit, and it was in the Indian Ocean, and it impacted all those nations that are around it, right? Well, in this specific beach resort, everybody there was full of tourists on that day. Everybody was just having a good old time, right? Just enjoying the nice water, enjoying the nice tropics. And all of a sudden, the water began to recede. Is that the correct word in English? Recede. Thank you. See, I'm learning too, right? We learn together. Began to recede. So I don't know about you, but if you're at the ocean and you see the ocean receding, you're going to be like, whoa. And so everybody came out curious to see what was happening. And they started picking out fish and shells and all the other things. But there was one person, the manager of this resort, who saw the sign and he knew what was happening. And he ran out to the beach. All the hundreds of tourists went out to the wall, to the sand. And he said, run for high ground. The tsunami is coming. A tsunami is coming. They're like, what? This one man that understood the signs, that was able to identify and see what was happening, he warned all the people on the beach. And guess what? They didn't know, but they saw this guy running out of their tongues, and they said, out of his mouth. And they said, I'm going to listen. Everybody ran up to the mountain. And guess what happened, my loved ones? The tsunami came. And tsunami killed more than 250,000 people. Millions of people lost their homes, lost everything. But every single person in that resort, my loved ones, survived. You know why? Because one person looked and understood the signs of the times. Amen? Jesus Christ, my loved ones, is giving us the signs of the times in his word. He's revealing through prophecy the things that are going to happen. Why? So that we can run to high ground too. So that we can be ready too. When the tsunami comes and the destruction comes, God wants us to what? Get in the ark. As it was in the times of Noah, so will it be. Destruction is coming on this earth, and Jesus Christ is what? He's warning us through his word. He's warning us through Revelation so that we can get safe ground inside of his ark. Who says amen? And so, my loved ones, as we finish tonight, I want you to know that what we're going to be doing is we're going to have a fabulous, wonderful time. I'm going to tell you right now, the devil doesn't want you to come. The devil is going to do everything possible to impede you from coming. Why? Because he knows that his deceptions are going to be unmasked, unveiled during this seminar. Amen? And so I encourage you to not only to come, there are handbills there where you're sitting, bring somebody with you. Encourage somebody to come, your neighbor, your friend, your co-worker. Tomorrow at 7 o'clock, what's the topic? If God is love, why is there so much pain and suffering in the world? This is the number one question among non-believers, among atheists, agnostic, which I used to be one of them. And I said, how is it possible that God is love, that God even exists, and so much pain and suffering? What is that? How is that possible? Tomorrow, my loved ones, I'm going to show you that the Bible is also the same question appears and is answered redundantly and powerfully. Who says amen? So tomorrow, a major question. Remember, you have your DVD. If you bring a guest tomorrow, they'll get a DVD too. Remember to do your study guides. You'll be participating with Amazing Facts Bible study, Bible school. So do the Bible studies. If you fall behind, don't worry. Don't get stressed. We'll wait for you and we'll work at your pace. Amen? Amen? But there's one promise I never want you to forget when you walk out of this place, my loved ones. Isaiah 41:10. What does it say? Do not fear, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will always help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I have a question for you tonight. Is there anybody here that says, you know what? I need to have a closer walk with my Lord Jesus Christ. I want to be ready for these events, and I want to share this news with the people that I love so that they're ready for the things that are happening and the things that are going to happen. If that is your case tonight and you said, I want a closer walk and I want to understand His word better, stand up in the name of Jesus Christ if that is your desire tonight. Amen? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Who's excited? I'm ready to go another hour, but I know you have to leave. Amen? So, the plan is every night, as we go, start at 7 o'clock, finish at 8:30. Amen? Because we know you got to get up in the morning, got to work, whatever. Weekends, you know, a little tricky, but that's okay. We're here. Listen, when you walk out of this place tonight, you are all going to receive Isaiah 41:10. And I want you to do something with it. I want you to take that Bible verse, and I want you to put it on your mirror, in your drawer, in your room. Make copies of it. Put it in your work. And every time you feel like you can't go on, every time you feel like you're overburdened, every time you feel like the enemy is just calling you down, I want you to read this promise. Make as many copies as you want. Put it all over the house. And later on, I'm going to tell you my testimony about this verse and how this verse has kept me afloat. This is like water. It says there, I will always, always help you. Amen? Read that promise and know that if you want to be with God, God will always be with you.